Welcome to Absolute Match Fishing. I was brought up fishing great big open expanses of water. I love it when it's rainy, it's windy, it's blowing an hurricane. It's proper raw fishing. I love it when it's like that. We're here at Southfield Reservoir and we've got two experts to show you how to tackle venues just like this. We've got Adam Wakelin and Scott Geens. They're fishing behind me at the moment. Let's just pop down and see how they're getting on. Hi, pal, you all right?
Hi, Tommy, how you doing?
I'm all right, mate. Are you catching up?
Yeah, it's got a couple in the net, getting a few more indications now, so right. Should be in for a few, I think.
Right, you're fishing short or long range?
Fishing long, 70 metres right. Today.
So what are you fishing? Are you fishing bomb, feeder or what?
Fishing a feeder, a cage feeder.
Right.
A Dutch master feeder. Right. For the distance, because I'm chucking that far.
Right, bring it in, let's have a look at it then. What's that, a nice medium action
rod? Yep. It's got a bit more power in the tip, Tom, because we're fishing so far out.
At that distance?
Yeah, we just want a bit more extra power, two thirds up the rod for casting.
Right. Well, that looks an easy enough setup, doesn't it?
Yeah, because fishing 70 metres, we like to make sure it's accurate, so we're casting in the same place all the time, and especially seeing as we've got a crosswind.
That's a big weight, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a Dutch master bullet, all the weight's at the bottom. So obviously when we punch it out, we're making sure we're hitting the clip every single time, because it flies lovely through the air.
Right, and is that just a quick tool so you can change the size of feeders if you want?
Yeah, these feeders, they come with all different weights on, different sizes and that, so I can quite easily snap that off.
And for another one?
Put another one, bigger, really? Smaller.
Now you've got a link to that, right? It's not running onto anything.
No, we've got a just simple paternoster.
Right.
4 inches of paternoster down, running down to some 0.117 hook length.
Right.
That's quite important. Because we're on a natural venue today, Tommy, what I like to do, I like to fish with 50, 60 centimetre hook length.
Right.
And obviously combined with the boom down from my main line. That makes it well over a metre.
Right, but when that drops to the bottom, that'll just drop basically on top of it.
Yeah, yeah, hopefully. Yeah.
So it's near enough, going to be near enough to your feeder.
So it'll be around the feeder, yep.
Yeah. What size hook you got on?
Just got an 18 on, just two dead reds at the moment.
Ah, right.
That seems to be the winning.
Right.
So, yeah, good.
Right, excellent. All right, then. Go on. How do you fill your feeder up? Show me how you do your feeder.
So we're getting a few more indications. I've started putting a few more baits in, Tom, today.
Okay. Like in casters and maggots?
Yeah, casters. So we're getting a few more indications. There's obviously a few fish in the peg.
Yeah.
So what I'm doing, with these, especially with these Dutch masters, the best way I found to feed them up, to load them up, sorry, is to like a scooping action. So
put your fingers at bottom.
Fingers at bottom, dead right. Lift your boom up.
Yeah.
And just scoop it in, all in from the top.
Yeah. And a little squeeze.
Little squeeze, right. Perfect.
Oh, look at that.
So on impact, Tommy, when this feeder hits the water, because it's still a cage and we've got a nice fluffy mix, the impact as well, the ground bait will come out on impact and obviously leaving a bit bigger bed. My hook bait's following it down on top. We've got one on.
Right. Show me how you put your hook bait on.
Because we're casting so far, a little tip for everybody. What I like to do for the balance, I like to hook one normal like you would a normal maggot.
Yeah.
Then what I like to do is hook one through the tail.
Oh, right.
So we're topping,
look at that. We're top
and tailing.
Look at that. How good is that? Go on then, mate, catch me a fish.
I'll catch you one. So like I said before, Tommy, we've just got a nice 12 and a half foot rod.
Yeah.
We're quite tippy up the top because we need it to cast this one out. We're just a simple launch. Nice and high. We've hit the clip.
Hit the clip.
Which knows we need to hit the clip to make sure that we're in the same place every time.
And also hitting the clip straightens your hook bait out past it. Dead as right, well, so you don't get it tangled.
Especially when we like to, obviously the length of us drop when we're casting gives us more height. So the more height we've got, the more higher up in the hair we're going to hit his clip for his hook bait to go past his feeder.
Right, that's excellent. Right, tell me about your setup, because you've cast in a straight line now, you've got your line straight, but you've put your rod at a nice angle, like almost like a 90 degree pull towards where you've cast. You haven't got it pointing directly at where you're casting.
The reason why I have my rod like this, Tommy, is obviously because when we get a nice pull off a bream and a skimmer, we like to see the bite.
Okay.
We like to watch it develop. Obviously, if you have a rod pointing like you would say if we were caught fishing to islands, obviously you wouldn't see those little bites, those little knocks.
Right.
So now, I mean, you know, I can see every little touch that we get.
Right. Brilliant. Excellent, that. That's on, Paul.
Yep. Yes.
That's on.
I thought you said it were a little one.
I think you're kidding me.
Decent little skimmer, Tommy.
Yeah, good fish there, isn't it? Lovely. Well done, mate.
Met the average stamp for today, I think.
Mmm.
No, you'd take getting one of them every chuck, wouldn't you?
Oh, yeah. Lovely fishing that, mate. You can see what you've caught it on as well, a worm, so...
Yeah, a little red worm with a top with a red maggot. It's been the best bait.
Right, well done, Scott. That's brilliant, that, mate. Now you've got all your terminal tackle out, can you just show me your setup?
Yeah, pretty much, Tom. It's just a standard cage feeder approach.
Right.
Paternoster.
Yeah. Which is just... That's fixed, isn't it, yeah?
Yeah, just braided up the last 6 or 8 inches of my main line.
Yeah.
And the hook length just sits above there on a loop-to-loop.
Right.
Dead simple setup.
Dead simple, that, isn't it?
Absolutely.
And your hook length?
Hook length about 2 foot. Started off a bit longer. We're getting a few bites now, so I've shortened it up a bit.
Is that because the fish are coming to the feeder, you feel?
Yeah, they're getting in amongst the grub and, right, you know, the bites are getting a bit more positive, so I've shortened it up.
Right, and what's your hook?
16's hook. It's a PR344.
Mm. Right, and your hook bait?
Best so far has been two little red worms tipped with a dead red maggot.
Can you show me how you put them on hook, please? So you just got a nice red worm.
Little red worm straight out the compost.
Yeah.
Tried little segments earlier. But
just took it through head.
Literally just hooked through the head.
Oh, two.
Two little ones. And then I've just tipped it with a red maggot.
Right. That's just stop it wrapping around your hook.
Yeah, and stop the worms coming off.
Well, what bream can resist that?
Yeah, it's my favourite bite, the red worm.
Yeah,
for bream.
Yeah. Especially when they're feeding, you can pick the better fish out sometimes as well, whereas with maggot you sometimes get roach and other smaller species, but I mean look at that, how can a fish resist that? And what are you doing with your feeder? What are you putting in your feeder?
A little bit of mixture of chopped worm and casters.
Right.
But I don't like to mix them.
Right.
To start with.
Right. You don't put them in your ground bait then, you actually add them?
No, I add them to as and when I cast out.
Right.
I like to that because some days you'll find that they want more casters than worms.
Oh, that's fair enough, yeah.
And other days they'll want more worms, so...
That's a good tip,
well, keeping
it
all separate, you can put the amount in you think's right for the any given day.
Show me how you do that then.
Today I've just been cutting a few casters.
Yeah.
A little bit of worm.
Right.
And then just plugging it with ground bait.
Right. And your ground bait's really yellow.
Yeah, I mean, yellow for bream is, I think, absolutely essential.
Right.
A little bit of colour in the water today, you get a nice cloud off you. I think, you know, the bream come into that cloud. I like it when they grub about on the bottom as well and it churns it up.
Right.
Yellow just seems a really good colour.
Well, it's working today anyway, that's fantastic. That's a great tip. Right, catch me a fish then.
We'll certainly try.
You don't seem to be casting out as far as Adam.
No, Adam's gone quite long.
Yeah.
I've gone 45 turns.
Right.
Which, what the locals have told me, is sort of, you know, where a lot of the fish get caught.
Yeah.
So I'm sticking with that at the moment.
Right.
Just a nice lob.
Yeah.
On the clip at 45 turns on a 4,000 reel, so.
Right.
It's probably less than 40 yards,
yeah,
to be honest.
Yeah.
36, 38 yards.
Now, I've noticed you're fishing braid. Can you tell me why you're fishing braid? Because it is different to what most anglers use.
Yeah, I've done a lot of bream fishing over the years and I've experimented with lots of lines, you know, pre-stretch lines, conventional monos, and braid for me just gets you a lot of bite. You know, there's little or no stretch at all. It just accentuates the bite, particularly today. It's been quite difficult to start with.
Yeah.
And some of the bites have been very tetchy. I don't think you'd have even seen them on a mono,
right,
conventional mono line.
Right, that's a fair comment. What about, if you hook a fish on braid though, because there's no stretch in it, is it, you've got to use different kind of rods, softer rods or anything like that?
Yeah, you don't want a rod that's too stiff. You want something that's a little bit through action. Got a nice 12 foot sort of medium feeder rod.
Right.
It's comfortable for that sort of distance cast, but it is soft enough to play the fish on the braid.
Yeah.
So you do feel every lunge with braid, so you've got to be careful.
And just take your time basically and get them in.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Brilliant, that's fantastic, mate. Now then, Paul, you've had a few more, haven't you?
Yeah, we've put a few together now.
But you've changed your style of fishing, haven't you?
I have, yeah.
Right, you better show me. Tell me why you've changed.
Just on these natural venues, Tommy, sometimes, you know, there's quite a few places that like it. The method feeder even still works. Catching
right.
these uh, sort of mugs these natural fish. It's quite quite a trick, really.
That's a different setup completely.
Yeah, we've got a 30 gram inline feeder.
Yeah.
But what I've done, because the rule says that it don't have to be free running, got a little
feed. And that was in the bottom of
there. That was in the bottom of there, and that makes it fixed then.
So it bolts it, so basically, it bolts it. But it's still free if anything happens.
Yeah, if anything happens up top, that'll come free, slide
right.
off.
Right.
But it's just a little, just to make sure they up themselves.
That's different, yeah.
Same again. All we're doing is mimicking the up bait closer to the bait, really.
Right. Right. So you hope it fish just comes... What,
straight away.
Show me how you put your bait on that. So we've got a mould.
Got a mould. Just cover the bottom first.
Yeah.
Finger middle.
Right.
Up bait in middle.
Yeah.
Like that. Same again. Cover him up.
Yeah.
Lay my line back across. One squeeze. One squeeze again. Quick release button on the back. Push it.
Oh, bring it out. Right. And the two maggots are in there.
The two maggots are in there.
And you've had a few on that as well, so.
Yeah. Like I say, especially when now it's got better and better.
I like that. Look at that. How good is that? That's beautiful, that. One thing that's puzzling me is you've got two different setups going to the same distance. How do you get the same rods going to the same distance?
I'll show you my little trick, Tom.
All right, come on. Now, what's this?
These are measuring sticks.
Right.
Want me to show you?
I thought they were to keep your crowd away, to be honest with you.
Yeah. Just mega, mega simple.
Yeah.
Two sticks, 2 metres apart. Got my feeder.
Right.
Drop my feeder down one side.
Yeah.
Falls down to the bottom.
Right.
What we need to do, just take your back wind off and we just go around the post.
Ah.
So that's 2 metres. 4 metres.
Right.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And so on. And just keep going.
So if you go 20 times, that's 40 metres.
That's 40 metres. The really good thing about this is, Tommy, with these two sticks, is that you can get away using two different reels.
Right.
So you could get, like, say, use a 4,000 reel and a 5,000 reel, but your distance is always the same. So when you get to 40 metres, Tom, just flick your bail arm over, find your line clip, clip him up, and that's your 40 metre mark.
And you're always going to go to the same spot.
Always to the same spot. Then all you simply do is just wind back on your sticks.
Take them off
one at a time. Dead right.
That's a great tip, that. That is a great tip.
I'm looking forward to the match we're going to have a little bit later. It's been a decent day so far. So if things pan out as they have done so far, we're quite confident. Yeah, Adam's he's not caught a lot as of yet, but he's a fantastic angler and fiercely competitive. So there'll be no complacency for me if I need to beat him. Yeah, I'll give it a little flick when I've cast in, because with braid, it does float naturally. I do soak it prior to fishing, but the little flick just gets it through the surface tension and gets it basically onto the bed of the lake. If not, it can get dragged away with the tow.
Well, it's, catching a few fish now. Really looking forward to the match. Scott's a brilliant angler, so it should be a good competition, really. My method's quite a lot different to Scott's, fishing longer. Normally takes a bit longer to sort of build up, but hopefully by the time the match comes later on, it'll all be flying by then.
It's only a little one. Yeah, fishing's going really well today. We've had quite a few decent sized bream, and this is a sort of average stamp we've had. We're getting bites regularly as the day progresses, and it's perfect bream conditions today, so hopefully long may it continue.
Well, it's wild and windy at the moment. It's perfect bream conditions. And Adam and Scott are both catching fish. Scott's at 40 metres, Adam's at 70 metres. They're catching fish for fish. But which is the best, which is the quickest? I don't know. So I'm going to give them a little competition. Half an hour's fishing to see how many fish they can catch to find out which is the best length to fish on this particular day. All in! Well, match has just started. Not sure it's best time to start because they did slow down a little bit, fish, but it's quite exciting, really. But one's long, one's short. We'll find out which is best.
You got one, mate?
Yeah, first.
First fish this pot. You haven't got one yet.
Oh, it's a big one and all.
It's a
beauty.
But he's thinking, get off.
He's in the pan,
Oh, we're away. Oh, he's not, he didn't like that.
Doesn't he?
No, he's not happy.
Oh, it's a big one and all, Tommy.
5 pound start, well done, mate.
Beauty.
He won't come in off, will he?
No, it's right down the gut.
Right start. First fish, 5 pound up. I don't think Scott's right happy about that.
Well, the match has just started. Adam's got one straight away. He might have caught a quick one, but he's still well behind over the full day. So we're not too concerned just yet. Big line bite there, must admit. I thought he was on for a minute, but it was clearly a line I've picked up, and there's nothing there. Be interesting to see if the bite's damaged. Yeah, it's probably a big fish, just swimming into the line, fin hitting the line. You get it quite often with bream fishing, but it's a good indication that there's still some fish in the peg.
Well, about 5 minutes gone. Adam's had a great start. He's had a bream, 4.5 to 5 pound, a proper fish. Scott still hasn't caught any fish, but there's still a long way to go, so we'll see.
So I'm one fish up at the moment, but it's looking like it's going to be hard.
Any signs, Scott?
I just had a liner then.
Have you? Try not to catch it.
I'll do my best. Yeah, let's put a few casters, a few worms. Trying anything we can to pull back the one fish advantage Adam's got. But, we've unclipped as well and gone a little bit further. Hopefully that'll get us a bream. At the minute, I definitely need one. I've cast in now. It's been in for 5 minutes or so. What I like to do, if I've not got an indication within that 5 minutes, is just try and induce a bite, quite literally just by moving the bait. And all I do that is just grab the line, it's sort of between the butt ring and the reel, and just give it a decent enough tug, and then just take up the slack on my reel. Hopefully that'll just move the bait and induce a bite.
We've just put one of them big ones?
Yeah, just put a single big dendrobina on.
Yeah?
Gone around straight away, yeah.
That's weird, isn't it?
Got to make sure we get in the net, Tommy.
Well, look, they don't count unless they're in the net.
Look at the big worm, look up the line.
Look at that. That's a proper man's bait, that one.
He's in.
Come on, mate. You're in trouble, Scotty. What's that, 3.5?
No, it's a bit bigger, I think.
4. I reckon that's 9 pounds you've got now.
Well, Adam's had another one there. My swim's gone a bit quiet, so not having the best of times at the moment, but we're still confident. We know the bait's right. We know the method's right. I'm sure it's going to go round. We'll have him back. Don't worry about that.
Well, we're 15 minutes into the match. Adam's just had his second bream, a 4-pounder. He's now got 2 for 9 pounds. Scott still hasn't had anything, and we're halfway through.
This is game on for Mr. Wakelin, because it's a proper one.
Oh, well done, mate. This is really going to make it close. We haven't got long to go. If you'll get this and another one, it's going to be really, really close. There we go.
Well, I think...
2-pounder.
If I can get back in quick enough, there's every chance I'll get another one, because I've just started to get a few liners again. Well, nice fish again, Tommy.
Well done, mate. 2-1 now.
Well, we're into the final stage now. 2-1 up. Scott's got one little one, so I think one of mine's enough to do him. So he wants to pull something out of the bag quite sharpish to be in contention of beating me.
I'm I need to make this one count. But I've been getting a few indications, so I'm hoping last couple of minutes I can just nick the spoils.
Come on, get yourself round.
Well, Scott's just took to fish. There's a minute to go. If he gets this, it's 2-2. If he loses it, Adam wins 2-1. It's all to play for.
Yeah, I think final minute of the match, and hopefully, if we extract it, might be the leveller.
Well done, mate.
I think if this goes in the bag, it's the leveller.
It could be too hard, this is close.
Oh, and there it is.
Sorry, well done, mate.
I reckon that's too hard, that.
It's a nice fish as well,
it's a
mate.
Big fish, 4 pound of that.
Just what we needed, Tommy.
Yeah, well done, mate. Perfect, that.
One final cast, hopefully. One final fish.
Well, Scott's having his last cast at day, but I'm afraid it's all out. Well, that was really exciting at the end. It finished 2-2. It just goes to prove you can fish long, you can fish short, but when you're patient, the fish will come to you. But you've got another chance in the final to beat each other. We'll see you next time for another Absolute Match Fishing.